Hi, I'm Rui Pereira da Costa, organizer of this International Leno Masters 2015, and it makes me very happy to present my friend Bojidar Kafelov, who's presenting the next lecture. Bojidar is an excellent clinician, and his clinical cases are much appreciated in lots of forums in the internet, both in endodontics as in aesthetic rehabilitation. He graduated from the Medical University of Sofia Dental School, and he has completed many continuing education courses in the field of endodontics since then. Bojidar will present about a topic he loves and where he excels, direct post-endodontic restorations. With a beautiful presentation, I have no doubt you will both love it and learn a lot from it. See you soon.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the first online endodontic congress, the International Endo Masters 2015, made possible by Rui Pereira da Costa from Portugal. I'm really honored to be part of such event. 35 lecturers from 23 countries. It's really a marvelous thing. Thank you, Rui, for doing all of this organization. My name is Bojidar Kafelov. I'm from Sofia, Bulgaria, and today we are going to speak about post-endo and posterior composite restorations. And the first thing I would like to show you is that I've tried many different ways to film this video lecture. I've tried different techniques, different cameras. I wanted to do a classy video, so at first I tried the widescreen recording and it came out like that. And then, of course, inspired by Stefan Klinge, I decided to make a green screen recording, and I looked slightly better, and the final result is this. It's me sitting in the Sweden Dental Clinic in peace and serenity, and I hope that you will like my lecture. I want to take several minutes to introduce myself. This is me in Sweden Clinic, working 90 to 95% of my working time. I'm doing endodontic treatments and post-endo restorations, and 5-10% of my time I'm doing posterior composite restorations. I rarely do anteriors, and that is the topic for today: post-endo and posterior restorations. My first love is endo, and when I was starting, I was afraid of doing composite restorations, and they didn't look well. But with time and practice, I started to improve my composite work. And back then I was thinking that composite restorations are rocket science. And with this lecture today, I want to show you that it's not rocket science, and everyone, if I can do it, everyone can do it. So I think we should get started. There are several problems that we should get rid of. The first problem is time, because we all have busy schedules and very hectic schedules, and we try to manage between patients, and we try to manage the patient's appointments. But we have to take time in every step of the composite restoration. We have to take time for the root canal treatments, for our irrigants, for the obturation. So we need time for everything. And the second problem is that we have a little devil on our shoulder whispering in our ear that posterior teeth don't need to be aesthetic and don't have the need to look good. But in my opinion, it's not like that. Because of the aesthetic appearance of a posterior tooth is directly related to function. And we are always in the middle of this fight between good and evil. Should I place a rubber dam? Do I have the time for staining and for photos? Do I have the time for proper occlusal anatomy? Should I use a wedge here? And I hope that I will answer these questions, and with this lecture we can shift our thinking towards the good part of the fight. I consider the restoration, the composite restorations, as a path, and every restoration is the same, because you have to get through that path one step at a time, and each step is important as the other. So let's go through that path together. The first step is isolation, and when I speak about isolation, I'm speaking about rubber dam, because in my opinion this is the only way to have a predictable isolation and to achieve perfect control over saliva and blood contamination. And when we are doing endodontic treatments on severely destroyed teeth, we can easily get blood contamination from the subgingival margin of the tooth. So I think we should spare a little bit of time on isolation to do it properly and to have a perfectly isolated working field. The next step, this is the cavity preparation. We should have smooth walls here. We should decide if we should reduce the cusps if we are doing post-endodontic treatment, and we will talk about this a little bit later. Then we have a very important step, adhesion. We have to do proper etching of the enamel or the dentin. We have to do a proper placement of the primer, and after that the bonding agent. And we should be really sure that we have done all the adhesion steps properly. Of course, after the adhesion comes the composite modeling, and we really need to take our time first to make the perfect occlusal anatomy, because the occlusal anatomy is directly related to function. And also we should take our time to make the perfect proximal contact with the adjacent teeth in order to have a good periodontal health. And after the anatomy comes the last but not the least important step, and this is polishing, because if you want to have good results in the long term, we need to polish well our restorations. And maybe you will ask, is this path the same for the post-endodontic restorations? And the usual question is, I'm an endodontist, should I make my own restorations, or I can refer to the prosthodontist, or I can send the patient back to the referring dentist? And my opinion on that is that we as endodontists should make our own restorations in order to take responsibility for the whole case and for the whole treatment. Because if we are missing an endodontic restoration, the tooth resembles a guitar with a missing string. And what do I mean by that? If you don't have one string on the guitar looks the same, it sounds more or less the same, but you can feel that something is missing. It is the same with a tooth with an improper restoration, or a tooth which lacks a coronal restoration. And I will illustrate that by showing you a case. This is a case of mine which I did in 2010. I've published it in Roots magazine as a case report. This is a case of radix entomolaris, and I've managed to find all the root canals, to clean them and to fill them. I also treated the second premolar, and I sent the patient back to the referring dentist, asking her to do the restorations, the final restorations, the prosthetic restorations. And this is what I saw after 6 months. You can see that the crowns don't fit well at all. You can see several open margins. You can see on the premolar that the crown is shoulderless, and I've prepared the tooth with a shoulder. And if the treatment, the endodontic treatment, fails, it will fail not because of the endodontic treatment itself, but it will fail because of the lack of coronal seal and the lack of good coronal restoration. So how to avoid that? How to avoid that missing string in our treatments? We should know what does the patient want. And I think it's very simple. The first thing that patients want is function. They want to chew with their teeth. And the second thing is aesthetics. We didn't have any patient that came to our clinic asking for a non-aesthetic treatment. And I'm not speaking just about anteriors, I'm speaking also about posteriors. But in order to develop an aesthetic treatment or aesthetic restoration, and we should define what is aesthetic and how can we achieve this aesthetic result. And I think for both patients and dentists, the most aesthetic thing is nature. So my goal when I do my restorations is to achieve aesthetic result, meaning to achieve natural result and to mimic nature. And if you show this tooth to an engineer or an architect and say to him or to her that this tooth is beautiful, they will think that you are crazy. But I really think that the natural looking teeth are really beautiful, with all the stains, with the cusps and the fissures and with everything in them. And I really don't think that this is a natural looking result, thus non-aesthetic result. And also I don't think it's functional. You can see the missing contact between the premolar and the molar. You can see the lack of occlusal anatomy. You can see the micro leakage between the restoration and the tooth structures. And this is how I managed to change that. And in this case, you can see that the fractured restoration and lack of proximal contact between the teeth. With that you get food impaction, and you can see that none of the occlusal anatomy was replicated while doing this restoration. And this is the final result. So now let's see how to do that and how to get a predictable outcome in our restorative work. For me, the only way to get a predictable outcome is to stick to the KISS principle. And it doesn't have to do anything with the rock group KISS. The KISS principle means keep it simple, stupid. And that means if something works for you, don't change it. And stick to simple protocols and to simple procedures. And in order to keep it simple, you should have a protocol. And again, you should have a path with several checkpoints that you're doing in every restoration. So let's get to the clinical cases. I will discuss the different classes, class 1, class 2, severely destroyed teeth, and how we can restore them in the posterior region, and also endodontically treated teeth. Now we are starting with the class 1 cavities, and we are going to speak about one of my favorite techniques. I call it the stencil technique, and it's famous also by the name of stamp technique. It's a technique that is very lazy, because I tend to be lazy when I'm working, and I like simple protocols and simple techniques which can reduce my working time. This technique you can apply when you have retained occlusal anatomy, like in this case here. You can see the complexity of the fissures and the slopes and the cusps, and you can see that the natural anatomy is retained, and you can see also the caries underneath the enamel. When I isolate the teeth, I make the impression using a transparent silicone. Usually I make the impression as an impression for temporary crowns. I include one teeth in front. For example, here we have the first and second molar, and for this impression with transparent silicone I will include the second premolar, so I can always precisely place the stencil after I've made the preparation. After I've taken the impression with the transparent silicone, I prepare the teeth, and you can see that the cavities are not small. There is also a pulp horn communication on the mesial buccal pulp horn, which I decided to make a direct pulp capping with MTA and just a drop of liner glass ionomer cement on top of it. Then I do the etching and the bonding procedures. I placed a little bit of dentin shade composite, and I leave around 1 millimeter to the occlusal surface. And the enamel layer I'm doing with GC Genio Universal Flow composite, which in my opinion is the missing link between the normal composite and the flowable composites. It is a high viscosity composite. I'm placing the universal flow in the cavity, then I'm placing the stencil on top, and I light cure through the stencil. And this is the final result. You see that I've removed the excess composite. It's easy to remove the excess composite with a hand scaler or with the Acesso instrument from the Stile Italiano kit by LM. And after that, we just have to polish with rubber polishers. And I use occlu brush for the final polishing, and this is the final result after the occlusal check, which is not really needed because I just replicate the natural anatomy of the tooth. Here is another case. You can see again the complexity of the fissures, and I really don't believe that I could do the exact same job with the freehand modeling. That's why I'm using the stencil technique again. I made the impression with the transparent silicone, then I make the cavity. For this cavity, I was using micro preparation burr, which is a small round diamond burr, high speed diamond burr with a long shank. And this is the final result after placing the dentin shade, a little bit of dentin shade, and on top of it the Genio Universal Flow composite, and light curing it through the stencil. I get a lot of times the question, do you think these restorations are durable? Here you can see the nine month recall for this restoration, and I really don't see any difference between the immediate post-op and the 9 month recall. I don't see any leakage, I don't see any secondary caries. So that's why I think these restorations are predictable. And to make it even more simple, this technique is a combination of the bulk and fill technique by Salvatore Scolavino from Napoli, Italy, and the stencil technique. Here is the original anatomy. You can see in the central fossa that there is a little bit of discrepancy from the natural occlusal anatomy, so we can correct that later. I made the stencil with the transparent silicone, then I made the cavity. This is the bulk fill, which substitutes the dentin. For this case, I've used SDR as a bulk fill composite, and you can see that I left around 1.5–2 millimeters for the enamel shade composite, which is again a Genio Universal Flow. I've placed the Universal Flow in the cavity, and then I've placed the stencil on top. Light cure through the stencil. I usually light cure for 60 seconds through the stencil, and when I remove the stencil, I cure for another 60 seconds. And this is how the tooth looks after the removal of the stencil. You can see the excess composite, which is easily removed with a hand instrument, hand scaler. And I wanted to correct the central fossa, and I've placed a little bit of composite. So this is the corrected fossa, and also the tooth without the excess composite, just before placing the stain. I placed a little bit of brown stain in the fissures, and this is how the case looks after polishing. And also, this is the final results after the occlusal checks and after the final polishing. And you can see that this case looks really natural, and it took me about 40 minutes with the photos. And this is a black and white photo just to assess the morphology and to assess the occlusal anatomy. You can also do the stencil with a flowable composite, let's say a low-cost flowable composite, but there are two tips that you should keep in mind. When using a stencil made from flowable composite, you should isolate the tooth before making the stencil, for which I use topical anesthetic gel because it's water soluble and it has a gel form, and it lets the composite in the fissures, but it isolates perfectly. You should not use glycerin, because the glycerin gel goes away, and you can fuse the stencil with the natural tooth. And after your preparation, you should isolate the stencil itself. Again, I use topical anesthetic gel, because if you don't isolate the stencil, you can bond the stencil with the composite layer, and you end up with a meatloaf of composite over the natural anatomy of the tooth. So this is the case. You can see that the anatomy is very complicated, especially the lingual cusps are very picturesque. I took the stencil with the flowable composite, then I've prepared the cavity, and you can see that the cavity is not small at all. I did the etching and the bonding procedures. Again, I've placed small amount of dentin shade composite, just to leave around 1 millimeter. Then I placed flowable composite, Genio Universal Flow, and on top of it I've placed the stencil. Then I light cure through the composite stencil 60 seconds, and when I remove the stencil, I light cured again for another 60 seconds. And you can see the result almost doesn't need any polishing or finishing with burrs. So I just finished with rubber polishers and with ocular brush, and the case was done in, let's say, 20 to 30 minutes with the photos again. And now let's discuss the class 1 endodontic cavity restorations. You will see one case, because I don't get very often class 1 cases to treat. I don't get very often vital cases to treat. But in all of my cases, in all of the cases you will see in the presentation, you will see that I have the exact same protocol over and over again in every case. This is a vital case, 24-year-old male with chronic pulpitis. on 2 to 6, and you will see in every case during the presentations that I usually use ProTaper Next. For irrigation, I use 5% sodium hypochlorite, 40% citric acid, and the final solution is 95% ethanol, just to dry out the root canal system. In the cases you will see, I'm using the squirting technique because this is my main obturation technique, and the most of the restorations are done with just two shades, AO3 from Genial and AE is an enamel shade, which is adult enamel. And for staining, I'm using Gradia Intensive Color 6. This is the result after the endodontic treatment. Before restoring a tooth, we should make a plan how to do it. You will see that I use the exact same protocol in almost every case. First, I'm doing the dentin layer, and I'm not doing the perfect modeling, but I'm doing some modeling on the dentin just to know where are the cusps and where are the fissures. Then I'm doing the main enamel occlusal modeling, the main elements of the cusps. Then I'm doing the additional anatomy if needed, because not every time the tooth has additional anatomy, and the staining, and after that I'm done. So here is the case. This is the axis cavity. I really don't believe in the ninja axis cavities, but I believe in the philosophy as small as practical. So here the axis was as small as practical. I was seeing every part of the anatomy under the microscope. And the other part of the occlusal cavity is the old restoration, which I removed. I've sealed the orifices with purple flowable composite just to have an indicator where are the orifices and the pulp chamber floor. Then I made the dentin layering, and you can see the rough anatomy of the occlusal surface, and this is the final result after finishing and polishing. This is after the rubber dam removal, and you can see a white line on the mesial buccal cusp, which I fear that it is lack of adhesion, but it can also be a thick layer of enamel which is slight perpendicularly. So I was very happy to see that on the 6 months recall, the patient didn't have any problems with the restoration. It didn't have micro leakage or secondary caries. And now let's move to class 2 restorations. First, we are going to speak about class 2 posterior restorations. Then we are going to move towards post-endo restorations. For the posterior restorations, I want to show you a case that I did full restorations of a quadrant. So you can see the problems in the first molar. Mesial decay, secondary decay in the mesial fossa, primary decay in the distal fossa. On the second premolar, there was a distal decay, also a small mesial defect. And you can see the not satisfying result of the MOD filling of the first premolar. So I started with the first molar. And with it, I use a technique called custom rings, introduced by Jordi Manauta. You can read on the Stau Italiano site, you can search for custom rings. There are several articles by Jordi. And the custom rings are basically this. You are making a custom separation ring using a normal separation ring. I used a metal one from the Danville metric system and a blockout resin. You are placing the blockout resin on the buccal side and on the palatal side. Light cure it, then place the universal separation ring, the metal separation ring, and place some more blockout resin on top of it so it all becomes one, and you will see how the custom ring looks in one or two slides. Then after preparing the custom ring, I made the cavity. Here I also had a pulp exposure which I pulp capped with MTA and then a few drops of liner glass ionomer cement, and then I'm ready to place the matrix, the wedge and the custom ring. It's very important to prepare the custom rings with the wedge in place so the wedge doesn't interfere at the next stages. And with the custom ring technique, you can reproduce the natural contact if you had that in the beginning. So here is the custom ring in place with the matrix and the wedge. Now I'm starting the etching procedures and the bonding procedures. And after the bonding, in class 2, I always try to make and to turn the class 2 into class 1 using the centripetal technique from Nitzan Bichacho, who introduced it in 1994. Now I'm placing the enamel shade and I'm building the enamel wall. And after that, I'm placing the dentin shades. And on top of it, I'm layering the enamel composite. I tried to do stencil technique in the distal fossa, but I failed because I got the bond between the stencil and the natural tooth. So I decided to do it freehand. And this is the final result of the first molar. And now we are going to the second premolar. I would like to show you a video to illustrate how I did the second premolar, the distal cavity, and you will hear some rock music, and I hope you like it. Enjoy!
Couldn't find the releases, but it was straining and good outside of the
Now let's continue with the class 2 post-endodontic restorations, which are usually more complicated because we have to decide should we reduce the cusps or not, should we do a full cusp coverage. My usual preference is to not to reduce the cusps if I have enough dental tissues left, but if I have an undermined cusp, I usually reduce it, and if I have to do a full cusp coverage, I usually prefer to do an indirect restoration such as composite onlay or overlay or a crown. And again, I'm using the same protocol as in class 1. And also in class 2 posteriors, I try to do the class 2, to transform the class 2 cavity into class 1 by building the proximal marginal ridges and the proximal walls. Then I do the dentin shade layering, and I usually do a rough occlusal anatomy modeling. After that, I'm doing the main cusp anatomy, cusp by cusp, and then I'm doing the additional anatomy and the staining, and the case is ready. Here is a case of a retreatment. You can see that there are not much left two structures. I was asked to do just the endodontic treatment, and this case is one of the reasons because of which I like to perform my own restorations. It was sent to me to remove the lentil and to do the endodontic treatment. Again, the protocol is the same. Chronical apical periodontitis on tooth 4-6, protaper next used for shaping, same irrigants, same obturation technique, same shades used for the final restoration. This is the final result after the endodontic treatment. I've managed to retrieve the lentil and I finished the case in 2 appointments, and I had a 3rd appointment just in case I don't manage to treat the endodontic lesion and to fill the root canals in time. The thing is that the patient studies in Germany. So it's not he's not in Bulgaria all the time, and he's in Bulgaria before Christmas or right after New Year. I've returned the patient to the referring dentist, but she told the patient that I should restore the tooth. So I had one appointment for 1.5 hours the day before the patient leaves to Germany. So I ended up with this. This is the cavity preparation. Usually I will do full cusp coverage on this case because you can see the undermined cusps and the undermined walls. There are not much tooth structures left. But I decided not to do cusp coverage, and I've asked the patient to make the crown in Germany. I've built the mesial and the distal wall. Then I've placed a fiber post in the distal root canal, and I finished the case. And this is how the case looks after polishing and finishing. The thing is that I'm really sure that this case will fail, and it's very hard to get the patient for recall. And because he's studying in Germany and he's here during holidays, I think he doesn't have a problem with this tooth because he didn't call me, but I'm sure this is not a long-term restoration because of the cusp reduction, but really this was a herodontic case, a herodontic restorative case, Because I had to do something for 1 hour, 1 hour and a half, so I can send the patient back to Germany. Another case of chronic apical periodontitis, you can see the tooth was necrotic. The tooth was 2-6, again the same protocol for shaping, irrigation and obturation. This is the result after the root canal treatment. This is the 6 months recall. And this is how the tooth looked before restoration. Here I decided to keep the walls and to keep the cusps because I had two thick enamel and dentin walls. I decided not to do the reduction. And I've restored the tooth with the same protocol, making it into class 1, dentin, and then enamel, and then staining. And here you can see the buccal view of the tooth. This is the occlusal check. And this is the final result after polishing. And you can see how the tooth looks after 6 months. This is the last case of the class 2 restorations. You can see it's a severely broken down case. I really wanted to do this case with an indirect approach or a crown. I proposed an indirect overlay, composite overlay or a crown, but the patient refused and decided to do it directly. I agreed, but I had the consent of the patient that he refused my options and he chose to do it in direct manner. So this is how the endodontic treatment looks like. And in this case, I decided to reduce the cusps. So the layering technique protocol is the same. First to do the proximal marginal ridges and to transform the class 2 into class 1. Then I'm doing the outer enamel layer and the cusp tips. After that, I'm placing the dentin layer. On top of it, again, I'm doing the main occlusal enamel shapes. Then I'm doing the additional anatomy and the staining. And here is how the tooth looks with the two sectional matrices from the distal and from the mesial. You can see that I've prepared the palatal canal to place a fiber post because I think a fiber post is mandatory in such cases where we don't have enough tooth structure to support the buildup. Then I've built the two proximal walls from enamel shades, the mesial and the distal. This is how they look from the buccal view. Then I finished the cusp tips. This is from the occlusal point of view. You can see that the fiber post is placed in the palatal canal. This is the dentin layering. And after I finished the enamel layering and the staining, this is how the tooth looks. And this is how the tooth looks after finishing and polishing. And the last topic is severely destroyed teeth. This is the only time I changed my protocol and I don't use the centripetal technique. Here I'm usually doing first the dentin layer in order to get support for the enamel layer. Then I'm doing the proximal ridges, the buccal and the lingual walls, then the cusp tips, and then I'm doing the occlusal enamel layering. Of course, such cases are not meant to be finished by direct restoration. I'm always doing indirect restorations, but in such cases, I can practice my direct modeling techniques. Of course, after the enamel layering, I'm doing the additional anatomy if needed, and the staining. Of course, you don't need to stain such cases, but just for the practice, you can do it. If you have, let's say, 1 hour, you can try to do the build-up for 1 hour, and to do it like you're going to finish with that build-up. Also, we should do a good build-up because we need to have a reference for the temporary crown. And in order to do a good temporary crown, we should do a good build-up. This is a case of a male with chronic apical peritonitis, and you can see again the same protocol for shaping, irrigation, and obturation. This is the final result. This is how the tooth looks just before the build-up. You can see the purple composite. And this is how the tooth looks after the dentin mass is layered. You can see the fiber post, which is showing underneath the dentin. And you can also see the mesial wall from the enamel layer. And this is the finished buildup. Of course, this buildup was ground on the next day for a crown. But these cases are the perfect training session for our occlusal modeling, for our composite work. And this is how the tooth looks after the finishing and polishing phase. And I would like to show you how we can use the stencil technique for severely destroyed teeth. If you have a patient like this, and this patient wants to do the endo and the prosthetic work in just 2 weeks or just 1 week, you don't have much time to do several temporary crowns and to do the build-up again and to have a different session for the build-up. That's why I've removed the crown, and from the old restorations I made the crown preparation, and I've taken a transparent silicone key of the prepared tooth. Then I did the endodontic treatment. I've managed to remove the barbed brooch from the mesial canals, and this is how the tooth looks after the obturation of the root canal system. This is the endodontic cavity just before obturation, and this is the root canal anatomy obturated with the squirting technique. Now I'm ready for the build-up, and I can place a fiber post in the palatal canal. And in order to do the same build-up and to have the same shapes for the crown as before, I'm using the silicone stencil. I'm placing composite inside, and then I'm returning the stencil on top of the tooth. And this is how the prepared tooth looks like. And after some finishing, I can use the same temporary crown. And after a few days, the tooth will be ready for impression. You may wonder what is the point of this presentation. Now I would like to summarize the steps that I do during my restorative cases and during my restorations. And here's the protocol I use. First, total etching procedure, 30 seconds of enamel etching, then 15 seconds dentin etching, and then I rinse thoroughly for at least 15 seconds. I usually rinse for 30 seconds. Then I'm applying the primer and the bonding agent. I use Optibond FL as my main bonding agent. I rub the primer for 15 seconds at least, then air dry well the dentin and the enamel, and then I apply the bonding agent for 15 seconds. After those seconds, I gently air dry the bonding agent, and then I'm ready for the layering procedure. As I told you, for class 2, I'm using the centripetal technique from Bichacho. I'm building the proximal wall first. Usually I'm using AE or adult enamel, but if the tooth has a more yellowish appearance, I'm using A3, which is a body color, and I use it for the enamel shade. Then I'm replacing dentin by using an opaque shade, which is AO3 mainly. If I have a whiter shade of the tooth, I can use AO2. Then I'm doing the occlusal modeling for which I use again adult enamel, and if the tooth has a yellowish appearance, sometimes I use A3, which is a body color. After I'm finished with the whole modeling procedure and the whole layering procedure, I'm staining the fissures, and sometimes I'm correcting the anatomy by placing some additional anatomy here and there. Then I do the finishing and the polishing, for which I'm using Soflex finishing discs, red diamond burrs if needed for the occlusal adjustments. Then I'm using Kenda polishers, yellow flame-like Kenda polisher, and for the final polishing I'm using Occlu brush. And of course I want to share with you which tools I'm using for the build-up. We are going to get through the matrices I'm using, the composites I'm using, and the instruments I'm using. First, let's speak about the matrices. I use Denville matrices and V3 triodent separation rings, but you can use any contemporary metric systems on the market and they will do the jobs perfectly. Other metric systems are, for example, Palodent Plus or V4, again by Triodent, or the Garrison system, Compositite system, sectional matrices with Teflon inside, the Garrison Compositite separation ring. I think that any good metric systems will do the job perfectly for creating the perfect interproximal contact. For the composites, I've chose to use GC because they're ease of use. As I told you, I'm using the Genio Universal Flow. I'm using it for the first layer. I'm using it for the stencil technique because I really think this composite, the Universal Flow, is the missing link between the normal composite and the flowable composites. Then for the enamel layer, I'm using adult enamel usually. Sometimes I'm using a body shade, which is A3 or A2, but I use the body shade if the tooth has a yellowish appearance. Most of the time, 90% of the time, I'm using adult enamel as an enamel layer. I'm using AO3 for the dentin layer because it's an opaque shade, a really yellowish shade, so it gives the restoration the color I need. And for the staining, I'm using Gradia Intensive Color 6, which is olive oil. It really is meant to be green, but it's brown stain with a yellowish appearance. It's something between brown and green. And I don't like the classical brown stains because they have a red appearance. And I am staining after the enamel layer, and that's why I like a more yellowish appearance. I think it looks more natural. When I am staining, I place the stain in the fissure and then I wipe off the excess with a cotton pellet. And for the instruments, my favorite instruments are the LM instruments from Stahl Italiano. First, the applicator, which is a very thin spatula, and it's used to give the main shape of the dose, to give the main shape of the composite. The second instrument is Condensa, which I use for applying the composite into the cavity. The next instrument is my favorite, it's called Fissura, and you can use it for sculpting the composite and giving the composite the correct form, either using the cone or the really thin sharp tip, which can be very useful for doing the small fissures on the tooth, for doing the additional anatomy. You can see in the movie that I'm also using a micro brush just to give that blend between the composite and the tooth structure. And the last instrument from the kit I'm using is called Eccesso, which is a hand scaler, and I use it for removing the excess composite in the mesial or distal wall, and sometimes on the occlusal surface when I'm doing the stencil technique. So to summarize this presentation, I think Every one of us should learn to do their own post-endodontic restoration, because that's the way we get the responsibility for our own actions. And I really think for the posterior restorations that we need to practice every day so we can get better with every case we are doing. And I think also that only practice is not enough, and every one of us should get their inspiration from something or somewhere. And I want to thank the Stau Italiano crew and the Stau Italiano family for being my inspiration since my second year of student, because that was the first time I heard Simone Grandini speaking in Bulgaria. And from then, I really enjoyed the Italian way of doing composite work. And I really want to thank you for your attention. You can reach me at my email at any time. You can also contact me via Facebook. And this is the profile picture you will see. This is Mick Thompson from Slipknot, and you won't see this guy you're seeing on the video. So thank you for watching, and I hope you like it. And I really would like to hear some feedback about the lecture. Thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of the Congress. Bye.